That Jesus Christ is born. Good morning, everybody. Where are my keys at? There we go. Stand up, everybody. Gotta have my keys in the background. Hey, I was thinking about this morning. I want to set our hearts in motion. And what a beautiful invitation we have this morning. Psalm 118. The writer says this, David, he says, "Open to me the gates of righteousness, that I may enter through them and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord. The righteous shall enter through it. I thank you that you have answered me and have become my salvation." And I love that we have this invitation that our praise and our worship become gates, not only that we let the King of Glory enter in through, but there's something beautiful on the other side of gates, everybody, that we stepped into today. And what's on the other side of our gates of praise is Jesus himself. Amen, everybody. So let's pray this morning. Father, we thank you for who you are, and we enter into your courts with thanksgiving, praise on our lips. And we just say, let the King of Glory come in. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
sing, there's only one. There's only one strong enough to say. There's only one who overcame the grave. There's only one who's worthy of all praise.
Almighty God. yet to come, Father. So, Lord, if someone's needing healing in this room, would you touch them this morning? Let them know that the sickness is not unseen, God. That they're still your child and you care for them. Would belief come in this room where it hasn't been in a long time? Belief in a heart that needs to believe in you once again. Jesus, would you come? Sing even one.
For the earth began to shake, and the veil was torn. What sacrifice was made as the heavens
Amen. You know what I think about the song that we just declared and the reality in the heart of this season? You know, if Christmas is about anything, it's about worship. And the Magi, when they traveled a long ways to meet this child, they asked, where is this king born of the Jews? Where is he? Because we've come to worship him. And it says in verse 9, it says, behold, the star that they had seen when it rose went before them until it came to rest over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced exceedingly with great joy. And going into the house, they saw the child, Mary, his mother. And the posture here, they fell down and worshiped him. Then, opening their treasures, they offered him gold gifts, frankincense, and myrrh. And it just dawns on me that maybe you might be familiar enough with this story that they gave Jesus three gifts, but before they did anything, they acknowledged who he was. They fell down and they worshiped him. And the miracle and the reality of worship is that it reorients our perspective to see Jesus for who he is. And I don't know about you, but oftentimes I come to Jesus as a king because he's useful, not because he's precious. Sometimes we come to Jesus because of the treasures he gives us instead of us giving him treasures because of who he is. Jesus did not mainly come into the world to give us bread. He mainly came into the world to be bread. Jesus didn't mainly come into the world to heal us. He came into the world to be our healer. Jesus didn't mainly come into the world to give us provision. He came into the world to be provider. And the reality is that the king that we serve today is on a throne and he's seated. And I love that we get to come together and worship, because what it does, everybody, it reorients our hearts to the reality of who he is, that he's a good king, that he's a servant king, that he's a suffering king. And guess what? He has treasures for us, but before we ask him for treasures, let's see him as our treasure. Amen. Let's pray this morning. Father, we acknowledge that you are the King of glory. The psalmist said, who is this King of glory? The Lord strong in battle. So God, we acknowledge you as the great King. And just as we've declared it, God, we say, all hail King Jesus. God, even the rocks cry out, but not this morning, God. We are crying out from earth to our you, God, for who you are. You reign above all. There's none like you. And we give you and we lay down before you our acknowledgement and our worship before you. You are the one that we're after this morning. And so, God, I pray that whatever it is that we need today, that we would see you as a good king, as a good shepherd, and we would see you as Father. And so here we are, God, your children, looking up to the throne, seeing you where you're at, because if you are seated on the throne, that means everything is beneath you. Sickness is beneath you. Disease is beneath you. Depression is beneath you. Despair is beneath you. And so, God, have your way in this place. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Everyone said amen. Can we celebrate the King Jesus this morning? Amen. Amen. So good. Hey, can we thank Jess and our worship team for leading us this morning? Jessica, thank you. Well, hey, do me a favor. Why don't you turn to someone to your left, to your right, greet them this morning, and we will come back in. Everybody, how are we? Merry Christmas. We're getting there. Anyone excited about Christmas coming up this week? I know that there are some that love Jesus and maybe don't love Christmas as much. That's okay. You're welcome here. We're glad. We'll get through it together, everybody, okay? We'll get through it together. If you're not a fan of the holidays, we were making fun of someone on our staff where we just say, hey, man, we know you love Jesus and hate Christmas, but we're in this together because of all the craziness that comes around this season. But we just want to take a moment before we jump back and do anything else in the service. We just want to take a moment to acknowledge if this is your first time here at Church of the City, we're honored and glad that you're here. You came on a great Sunday, and we know that you could be anywhere on a Sunday. We're honored and glad that you're here with us this morning. And we won't have you stand up or do anything like that. But as you leave, if this is your first time, as you leave out the doors to the right, there's a guest area where we would just love to meet you and answer any questions that you might have about Church of the City, who we are, our ministries. Maybe there's just some general questions about who we are. We would love to answer any questions that you might have. Also, we would love to pray with you and to pray for you. Regardless of who you are, however you're feeling, wherever you're at, we would love to pray with you. We have a prayer team that their hearts are full, and they're expecting to pray with people today. They're trained, they love it, and it's their joy to pray with you. So if that's you this morning, if there's anything that we can do to pray for you or pray with you, we would love to do that. Just a couple announcements before we dive into the message today. In lieu of the Christmas announcement, we are having a few services Christmas Eve weekend on December 23rd. We have a 5 o'clock service, and then on the 24th, we have a 1, 3, and 5 o'clock service. All those services will be identical. All of those services will be family services, meaning we won't have any Kid City available. And when we say a family service, that simply means that we're doing things very intentionally in the service with children in mind. And so the service is going to be an hour and 45 minutes. Y'all got nervous. That will be a very intentional and strategic service length, but everything that we do in the service, there will be actually some elements where we're going to invite some of the young people to be a part of that in the moment. You don't need to prepare. I know if some of the Enneagram 1s and those of you that are planners, you're just like, what are we doing? What's going on with my kids? Don't worry about that. It's going to be very family friendly. It's going to be appropriate. It's going to be amazing. And all those services are identical. And I just want us to know this last week leading up to Christmas, for us to be very mindful and very prayerful of those who might be kind of in our sphere of influence, in our neighborhood, workplace, friends, family, that maybe aren't more prone to being a part of a church experience during the holidays or at any time during their life. Maybe they're de-churched and they were, you know, part of the church and had followed God, and maybe they've kind of fallen away and it's been a while since they've come back. I just want to encourage you, you never know what's on the other side of an invitation. And all of us in this room, at some point, if you're a follower of Jesus, you got prayed in or someone invited you, but the God of heaven invited you into a relationship with him. All journeys start with an invitation. You never know what an invitation can do and what God can do on the other side of that. And people are more prone to be invited, if they are invited during a time like this, to actually join you in service. And so that weekend message will be very laser focused towards those who need hope, who are without hope. And so I want to encourage you to be prayerful and just be asking, who can I bring with me for the Christmas service? In lieu of Christmas as well, one of the things that we do every year leading up to Christmas is we do a Christmas offering. And some of the things that we've done in years past, we've been very intentional to ask, what are the needs in season? What are the things right now around us, the felt needs, where we can just partner with, and we can end the year with gratitude and generosity, but we can also start the year and just have some momentum going into the new year. And so in years past, we've taken up Christmas offerings for various things, investing in our wraparound ministry. We've invested in our Celebrate Recovery ministry. We also sowed in to help launch Wholehearted Counseling, which meets right here in our building. And all those needs were in season. And so one of the things that we have realized that after 12, 13 years, that this space that we meet in actually needs some TLC. It needs some investment. And we might just look at this as a building, it's four walls, but this is actually a place where ministry happens. It's a common place that we turn into a sacred place because Jesus is there, the presence of God is there, and he will use this tool if we give it to him. And that's what's been our heart. And so as in lieu of that, there's a lot of feet that come through this building. We shared this last week if you were here, but there's over 50,000 people that have walked through this building in the past 12 months. There's a lot of ministries that happen here. On Tuesday night, celebrate recovery. On Wednesday night, our students meet. We have our Kids City meeting right over there. Hundreds of kids each weekend. Last weekend, we had over 500 people that were here for Fostering Hope. And so these are places and spaces in the four walls of this building where ministry takes place and lives are intersected and lives are changed. And so I don't know if it was in this service or last service, but we shared a statistic that if you look down at the floor, there's like maybe an 85% chance that there's a coffee stain on that floor. That's actually inaccurate. It's more like 96% chance. And so one of the things that we want to invest in as we steward this place well, this floor here and some of the floor out in the lobby area is beyond repair and it needs to be replaced. And so the reason that this is kind of our focus is our heart is because this is not one person's responsibility, but this is all of our responsibility. Here's why, because this is a family and this is our house. Everyone say, this is our house. And so all of us collectively together are going to come together and we're inviting you to participate and pray into that. Our family is doing that right now. We're praying into what can we give at the end of the year for this Christmas offering. This is our home, and together we want to take care of that. And so as we look forward to the end of the year, that's what we're praying into. Sound good, everybody? Last announcement, we're going to look forward to 2023, and as we look ahead, we've been sharing this. Just want to encourage us, Seek First is the season that begins right at January 1st, and we begin that year with 21 days of prayer and fasting, recalibrating our hearts together, again, as a family, seeking the Lord to pray and fast. And I just want to encourage all of us can fast from something. So choose a fast. And I just want to maybe give pastoral permission, because maybe for some of us in here, it's not lost on me that when it comes to food and eating and dieting and you think of fasting, maybe something that you're going through right now or maybe there's something that you're seeking freedom from when it comes to eating, this is not good for you. It's not good for you physically, and it actually does more harm than good when it comes to fasting from food. And I just want to give you pastoral permission that that's okay, and there actually is a way that you can still participate instead of abstaining from food. For many of us, maybe you fast from just sweets or a certain type of food. Maybe for all of us, it's a comfort entertainment fast. No entertainment, no Netflix for 21 days. I know, big deal. Whatever that might be, I just want to encourage you, if you haven't started having conversation with you and your family, what does that look like? Yesterday, my wife and I had some window time, and we said, hey, what do we want in the fast to look like? And we just had a good dialogue, and we're getting a plan together, so it's not like, oh, it's January 1, hey, we should probably think about doing this. Now's the time to start thinking about and praying through and planning, what are we going to fast from? And what are we leaning into? What are some things that we need God to do in our life? Because here's the reality. When you fast, you tune up and turn up of God's voice in your life. But what you also do simultaneously is you turn down the desires of the flesh and the things of the world. And so I want to encourage us as we do that to be very, very prayerful and just begin to enter dialogue with you and your spouse and the Lord. One of the things that we're doing that's unique during the 21 days is our prayer hubs. And we've announced this over the past couple weeks. We've been recruiting facilitators. And so we've got right around 15 different prayer hubs that are going to be gathering through Murray County, and Williamson County over the 21 days of the Seek First season, of this prayer and fasting season. So I just want to invite you, you can actually join a prayer hub. Most of these are going to be decentralized, meaning they're not going to be here at the church. They'll meet in other places and venues. And there's a QR code there as well as in the seat pocket in front of you to get more information to join a prayer hub. If you have questions about those or you still want to sign up, you can. You can find Meredith back at the prayer guest central area. Sound good, everybody? Yes. I lied. I have one more announcement. So sorry. Not sorry, but this is important. So on Christmas Day, that Sunday, There will obviously, we will not have service in person here. There will be a special online curated Christmas at home experience. And then the next time that we'll gather post-Christmas will be January 1. This will be important for all of us to know, to steward that time well and to steward that January 1 day, which is New Year's Day, falls on a Sunday, to honor our volunteers primarily. We're going to be having one service at 11 o'clock that Sunday, January 1st. It'll be a family service, and we will be streaming in the message, the sermon from our Franklin church. There's a guy named Tyler Staten, who is the director of the 24/7 prayer movement in the USA. He's a pastor of Bridgetown Church, and I just finished his recent book. It's called Praying Like Monks, Living Like Fools. And the reason that we're having him share, because we think it'll be a great launching pad to that series, because the first 4 weeks of the year will be a series on prayer, and I'm fired up. And so just be mindful of that. I'm going to invite Pastor Brendan up. He is going to deliver the last part of our Advent series leading up to Christmas. So let's welcome Pastor Brendan up as he brings the word.
All right. Good morning, Church of City family. Always an honor to be up here with you guys, getting to just jump into God's word as we get close to Christmas and just even talking about all things Advent. Like Tony said, my name is Brendan. If you don't know me, I'm one of the pastors here. I specifically get to hang out with our 6th to 12th graders and city students. There's a bunch of them over here. What up, city students? We're going to need more than that this morning. But yes, I hang out with them. I love what I get to do. I spend most of my week trying to create moments and spaces for these guys to encounter and experience Jesus and grow in their devotion to following him. And it's the best thing I do with my life. It's my great joy. But I am excited to be up here with you guys. And if you've missed the past few weeks, we have been in this series called Advent. And Advent to us is just pretty simply, we're anticipating and waiting for the arrival of the Messiah, of the baby king Jesus. And as we wait for him in the way of Christmas, it's also Advent in that we wait for his final return, when he will come for all of us, all of his people, to restore all things, and we'll be with him forever. Additionally, a third aspect of Advent for us is that we are anticipating what God is going to do right now in our hearts in this season, that he has a word for us right now, and we want to hear from him. So we're waiting and anticipating in that way as well. So I want to pray for us, and we're going to get right into it. So if you guys will close your eyes with me, we'll pray together. Father, we just want to come to you on this last Sunday of Advent and just press in to the word that you have for us. We are full of anticipation. And even just to pause our hearts right now, just to settle our breathing, our mind. Maybe there's 1,000 things that we're thinking through right now. What's the score? Is Argentina winning? God, we just want to lay all of those things down to you right now and just have you speak to us. What do you have for us this morning? Holy Spirit, would you guide this time? Open our eyes and our ears to what you would say. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You won't get many sports references out of me, but that was one of them. Okay, question for us all this morning. I want you to think of it, think of the answer, and then tell the person near you, okay? What is one of those Christmas traditions that you love the most, okay? What's a Christmas tradition you love the most? Think about it and then tell the person next to you, go. All right. Now let me hear from maybe two people, if you would be so bold as to share with a group, maybe a peculiar one or an interesting one. It could be a basic one, but I want to hear. Yeah, Annette, why don't you go? You make tamales. Yeah. That's pretty cool. Yeah, I was gonna make fun of whatever anyone said, but I don't think I can make fun of that. So that's just awesome. Okay, one more. Maybe on this side, someone. Yeah, right here. Michaela. That escalated quickly. Okay, so she said that they hide a green frog in their Christmas tree, And whoever finds it gets to become Santa for Christmas. What's the correlation between frog and Santa? We need a random item. There's a frog. Let's throw it in the tree. Okay. That is weird. Okay. I'll just call it. Call it like it is. No, that's cool. I'm glad you guys do that. I'm not doing that one, but one of my favorite traditions growing up was something my grandma would do. And my grandma is the crazy Christmas lady. Okay, she's got like 50 Christmas trees in her house. It's all decorated. She starts in like August, September, decorating the house. It's a little crazy. So we do all the Christmas stuff, parties and get-togethers back there. She lives in Vegas, and so I haven't been a part of it lately. And so probably since I've been alive, past 2-3 decades, Christmas has been at her house. And so for the first time ever, she is actually leaving their normal tradition. They're coming here, and they're going to have Christmas with us. So it's a big deal. We can give up for my grandma. Her name is Janice. Go, Janice. Okay. But one of the things I actually love that she did was she did an advent calendar. But what she did that made it really special is she would hide clues in it. And so I'd go on like these crazy scavenger hunts. But her house was insane, so it made it super difficult to find anything. Like she'd be like, there's a pencil over there. And I'm like, no, I don't see. There's nothing. There's a green frog, but there's no pencil over here. But I loved it, and now I get to bring it down to my kids, my son Luke and Benji. They do it, and so Benji's 2, and he'll wake up every morning. He's like, give me the clue. And he doesn't know how to say clue very fluently, so he just kind of says glue. But it's awesome, and I love it, and it's one of my favorite things. And we all have those, right? We have those, like, just niche Christmas traditions. They're ours. They're special, whether it's lights or going and seeing other people's lights or how you do hot chocolate or how you rep presents and when you give out the presents and the Christmas movies you watch and all the things, right? Christmas pajamas and all of that. And we even have a tradition as a church, right? Well, you're going to come here this week and we're going to give you a candle. We're going to give your children a candle. And we're going to light that candle on fire. There's going to be hundreds of open flames in this room. And we're going to sing Silent Night. And it's really sweet. It's one of the best parts of the service. And at the same time, you're like, how are we not all lighting on fire right now? But we do that. And the question I want to ask is, like, why? Why do we do these? And even if you're like, you know, Pastor Tony said it, like, even if you're like, I love Jesus, but I'm not a Christmas guy, your tradition is being a Grinch. Like, even that is a tradition. Why do we do that? And, yeah, I think you could probably say, you know, it's just what we've always done. We just keep it going, right? Bring it down. It's what my parents did, so I'm gonna replicate it. That might be it, but I think it goes deeper. I think we do these traditions because it evokes something in us. We're longing for something, and these traditions often bring us comfort, maybe some nostalgia, reminds us maybe of a better time, brings us back into memory, maybe somebody we've lost. It brings a sense of joy and hope, family and unity, connectedness. It brings wonder and awe and beauty. And we love it because it wakes up that in us, points to something deeper, a longing in our heart and our soul. And yet, even the sweetest traditions, the frog, the tamales, the advent calendar, being a Grinch, even the sweetest of traditions don't seem to satisfy that deep longing of our heart. I think we can see it in a couple things, two things really. If you've noticed this, Christmas is coming earlier and earlier. Right? I don't know how many people I've talked to about, do you start Christmas after Halloween or after Thanksgiving? And some of you are like, that's insane. But that's legit what's happening. You go in the store, and Halloween isn't even over yet, and Christmas is out, right? When do you get that Amazon catalog for the Christmas sales or the Black Friday sales? Like, it's becoming sooner and sooner, earlier and earlier. And just even to point that out, how many of you guys were, like, sprinting, just, like, survival mode to get to winter break or the holiday, right? Just like Friday, you're like, I'm going to leave as soon as I can because I want to start whatever that is, right? We want it sooner and sooner. And we can't help but look at the fact that Christmas is connected to our spending, our shopping. We want to go bigger and better. We want to get more and more. And I was looking at it. We're projected this year to spend $942 billion on Christmas. Now, 20 years ago, that was around $400 billion And obviously, I know a lot has happened in 20 years. The economy's changed, all of that. But that's a data point that we have increased our Christmas spending $500 billion in the past 20 years. It's a data point. And I think a couple of those things, there's probably more than that, but those are some reasons that I can't help but recognize the fact that maybe the tradition of Christmas is not as satisfying as we think it is. Maybe the tradition of Christmas is not as satisfying as we think it is. And I have a story that maybe you can connect to this, because it's not just Christmas, right? It's our lives, it's our faith, it's our family, it's our position and work and all of this stuff. And so recently, this past August, I turned 30, which is, yeah, it is what it is. And me and my friends went out to just like a nice steak dinner. That's like the one thing I wanted. And one friend in particular, you guys know him. His name is Mike McCarter, executive pastor here. He's back there. What up, Mike? Hey. Me and his friendship kind of goes like we egg each other on to do something dumb. Like we just kind of push each other to go more and more. And so we went out to dinner. And we were like, let's get something big. And so they had something at this restaurant called the smorgasbord. That's what it was called. And it's meant for four people. And me and Mike decided to eat it, just me and him, so two people. So here's a picture of it, because it looks disgusting. So it was a 40-ounce porterhouse with four pork chops on top, four lamb chops in the corner. I think there's like four shrimp wrapped in bacon, and there's some crab cakes and some stuffed mushroom. And just like, that's, you die after you eat something like that. I think that's just what happens. And so we ate that whole thing, and really gross, but it was delicious. And we had this joke, like right after, like, why don't we just go to Shake Shack and get a burger and a shake? It was like, we didn't do that, thank God. I would not be here. But the joke of it was even just like, man, in the just indulgence of that, it wasn't enough. Like, we were joking for more. And maybe if we would have pushed each other enough, we would have gone and gotten more food. I think it's safe to say we didn't. But it is, that story reminds me of the fact that, man, there's something in us. That's the joke one. But in reality, there's something in us. And it's not enough. We want more. We live these lives, I think, where we just are dissatisfied and demystified, maybe skeptical about the things of life or cynical. The way I'd probably say it is we've become awe-less. We've lost our wonder. And so we go for this quick fix, this quick hit of some kind of instant gratification, spectacle, whatever, that makes us feel good for a moment, and it's never enough. And we can do that with the holidays. We can do that with Christmas. But we can do that with a lot of things in our life. We want the latest piece of technology. We want the latest iPhone. And we go do all the things to get it, and it feels good for a moment, and then that feeling is gone. We get a new car or a new house, or we want a better position at our job or more money. We want to achieve or be successful. Those of you guys that are in C students, you want this college experience, and then you get there, and you're like, why did I put so much stock into this? College will be great. But we want more and all this stuff, and it just never is enough. All in an effort to give us a sense of what I would say is wonder. We long for wonder and awe and beauty in our world. We long to be satisfied. It's a longing of our soul. So one guy I follow, he's kind of like a theologian meets tattoo artist. It's very millennial of me. I follow him on Instagram, and his name is Josh. I don't know his whole full name, but his name is Josh. And he says this, which I thought was just really, really profound. So I want to read it to you. As kids, we're topped up with wonder. Magic lurks under every rock, in every cloud formation, and over every green hill. And then something happens. Something starts to bottom out our enchantment. We start to see the world, our relationships, our jobs, our calling differently. It becomes dull, dreary, and matter-of-fact, routine, ordinary. There's no magic we feel drawn to. There's no hidden beauty we crave. Well, that's not entirely true, because we are drawn to it. We do crave it, but often we don't know what it is or how to get there. So we settle. We settle these intense longings for Netflix binges, YouTube spirals, and whatever sort of thing we want to call the infinite scroll of Instagram. We're all after beauty, even if we have a perspective that demystifies every kind of beauty around us. So I want to ask you a question, and I want you to sit with it, maybe write it down, maybe think about it this week. What made you lose wonder? What's made you lose wonder? What's happened? And what is it doing in your life? Because we all have reasons, right? We all have the list of things that have happened to us that have gotten us here to this point. To where we've fallen asleep to the wonder of this life following after Jesus. What is really meant to be like and feel like and look like. Maybe we've gotten old, not physically, even though that's true for us, but in our hearts, in our faith, we're too busy, we're too tired, we're too distracted, we're too asleep, we're too settled. And so we want Christmas sooner, and we want it bigger and better, and we long for wonder, but we seek it in a spectacle that only lasts a moment. I think there's a better way. I think we need to learn to wake up the wonder in us again. I think we need to learn to see the beauty and adventure of life, to shrug off some of the lesser things for the greater reality. Josh again, he says, to read fairy tales again and let the beauty and the mystery wake us up as to what it means to be alive, to be human. Our lives as followers of Jesus are wrapped up in this beautiful myth, this wonderful narrative of redemption and kingdom and healing. And often, because we don't read the sorts of books, fairy tales, we don't know how to fan into flame the fiery passion for beauty. One day, we will be old enough, wise enough, to read what wakes us up. He's quoting C.S. Lewis in the dedication of The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, where C.S. Lewis says, "My dear Lucy, I wrote this story for you, but when I began it, I had not realized that girls grow quicker than books. As a result, you are already too old for fairy tales, and by the time it is printed and bound, you will be older still. But someday, you will be old enough to start reading fairy tales again." I think Jesus puts it the best in Matthew 18:3 when he says, "Truly I say to you, unless you turn and become like children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven." Not in immaturity that children have, but in the wonder, in the whimsy, and the adventure, and the awe, and the beauty. Childlike faith. What does it look like to wake up the wonder in us, to come alive in awe of the God who is writing our story, a fairy tale that we get to be a part of? I want to show you that God has a tradition too, and it's actually probably one, for me personally, I don't like so much. Maybe for you too. It reminds me of the one tradition, like I detest it so much, it reminds me of this one tradition that I grew up with where Christmas would happen and I'd wake up and I'd want to do presents and my mom would say, "Go get your little sister." And we have a 9-year age difference. And so I'd go up to her room and I'd, like, literally, she's a baby, I would carry her out down the stairs and my parents would just take pictures as I was walking down the stairs. Until I was 20. I was like, this is a problem, all right? Like, I don't have to do it anymore, thank God, but I detested it. I like just felt so, I was like, oh, my skin's on fire. I don't want to do this. It's like that, how much I did not like this. And that's how I feel about God's tradition that I'm gonna display here in a second. You know, God at work in the scriptures and his stories that we read, he does a lot of big things. Miracles and wonders that are all throughout display. He moves mountains. He makes a way in the wilderness. He parts the waters. He resurrects the dead. Like, just crazy things. We at Church of the City have a vision. Like, this is what we're all about, to see the fame and deeds of God renewed and known in our time. We want to see the fame and deeds of God. But I think often God's fame and deeds come at a totally different perspective. One that we wouldn't have expected. We wouldn't have said, that's how I would do it. God likes to work in the unexpected. He works through weakness and smallness and vulnerability. He works through weakness and smallness and vulnerability, humility. This is God's tradition. You see, in 2 Corinthians, when he calls us jars of clay that contain the glory of God, you see it in the story of David, who faces off against the giant, and he does what he knows to do. He takes some stones, and he puts them in his sling, and he takes care of business. Just ordinary, run-of-the-mill, young guy defeats a giant. Or a leader like Gideon, who's given the task to amass a large army to defeat the enemy force, and he raises 32,000 men, and God says, make it smaller and smaller and smaller until it's 300 people. Or Jesus takes a boy's Lunchable and feeds 5,000 people with it. God is in the business, it seems, to bring wonder and awe and beauty by the way of weak, small, and vulnerable. I don't know why. It's just what he does. And so it should be no surprise to us that God decides to save the world by coming not in the way we would maybe say to do it or what we would expect, and not in the way the people of the time expected. He comes in smallness and in weakness and in vulnerability. God becomes a man. He takes on flesh and vulnerability. The God of all things becomes a small thing. One guy, Strahan Coleman, puts it this way. He leaves heaven, committing himself to the darkness of human womb, to be vulnerably carried by us, to assume our nature and to bind himself to us forever. Then, through him, we are carried back into the womb of Trinity, to be vulnerably carried by God, to participate in his nature and to be bound to him forever. Christ's descent into humanity becomes our ascent into God. My prayer this Advent is that you're able to truly sit with that and let it become more and more the reality of your existence. Here's how I can point out how we don't like that. Because if you cringed at being carried, bound, vulnerable, any of those words, if that made you just like, oh, I don't know about that, that might be a sign that you're not with God's tradition right now. Because I know I cringe at those words. I don't want to be carried. I'm good on my own. I'll do it myself. I don't want to be bound. Don't tell me what to do. I don't want to be vulnerable. I can't trust anything. Maybe those are the things that are playing in your mind. We might not be about God's tradition, and yet this is how Jesus came to the earth. So let's talk about that. Let me point out two things. Recently, a few of us got to go on this amazing trip to Israel. It was actually supposed to happen years ago, so finally that it happened was really sweet and really special. And so we got to go with the master teacher, Christy McClellan. She's amazing. And she took us into the moments of the Bible. We were beholding the scriptures. We were walking the text. Except for this actual scene. This isn't in the Bible. But it's a place in the Holy Land. It's called the Herodian. It's this giant man-made fortress. The hill that it was built on was man-made. It's insane. This is a fortress that King Herod built. And we know King Herod from the Christmas story. He's the guy who's trying to kill baby Jesus. Like, guy's terrible, right? That's actually not even the worst thing he's done, which is crazy to think about. He was so paranoid. He was so power-hungry. He was so just like, everyone is out to get me. Any perceived threat, he went crazy. He killed his own children, his own wives, his own family members, to make sure he stayed in power. And then he also killed some young babies in the Bethlehem area. And he's done a whole lot more. This is the place at the point in time when Jesus is born that is the amass of power in the region. I want you to see the next picture. You can see Bethlehem from it. Now, Bethlehem back then, it's still not like the nicest part of the area, but back then it was just a poor village. They built their houses out of caves. This is where people of squalor and poor, this is the destitute. This is where they were at. A know-nothing village where nothing people existed. And this is the place that Jesus is sent. And I just think about it for a second. If you're God, where do you send your son to be born? In the place of power and prestige and provision? or poverty and weakness and smallness and nothingness. You have this fortress king, mad king, fighting for power against this poor village baby. Who wins in the power struggle? This is how God operates. Smallness, weakness, and vulnerability. He turns everything on its head. Our text for this morning that we are finally at, if you want to stand in the honor of the reading of God's word, is 2 Corinthians 12:9, which says this: "But he said to me, 'My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may rest upon me.'" This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. God, for whatever reason, wants to work in the weak things. He wants to display his glory, his beauty, his wonder, his awe through our weakness, through our vulnerability, through our smallness, through our humility. This is how God wants to work. And this is what he does in the story of Jesus. We just recently came out of a series in the book of Philippians. I want to bring us back to it for just a second. Philippians 2, 5 through 8. "Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped." Who is grasping for power? Herod. Jesus is not after that way. Instead, he emptied himself. Other versions say he became nothing. Became nothing. "By taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross." Jesus empties himself. He becomes nothing. And Christmas is simply a reminder for us. It's an introduction to Good Friday, that a baby came to die for you and for me. The birth of the Lord Jesus Christ isn't just a nice story to read on Christmas Eve, although we will do it and it's sweet and awesome. The incarnation of Christ should have a visible effect upon our lives. It is intended to make us a humble people. The call of Christmas is a call to humility. So what's our answer to the longing in our heart and soul? What's the answer to just wanting to go sooner and sooner and bigger and better? What's the answer to the spectacle and the filling and the quick fix of just trying to find wonder in ourselves? It's to be small and be weak and be vulnerable and behold the baby king. So have you lost your wonder? Have you settled for lesser things? My challenge, my call to you would be to not turn to a holiday. Christmas is great. But turn to the Messiah, the one this holiday is all about. One more quote. "I know even a holiday focused on Christ can't deliver what Christ himself can. So I encourage you, at the very least, think about the season ahead with a resolve to cultivate intimacy with him through his word and in prayer. A slow and steady beholding of Jesus can expand and deepen our experience of him every day, but especially on Christmas Day." I read that this week, and I said, that's the answer. If you're wanting to know how you find wonder and awe, if you want to know how to find the beauty of all things, it's by beholding Jesus, slow and steady. You know why? Because that requires vulnerability. That requires weakness. It requires smallness. It requires being emptied of ourselves. It requires us becoming nothing so that he can become everything. It's giving him all of the room and space, and it forces us to slow down. It forces us to let go of and relinquish control. And that's the last thing I want to do. I'm going to get to that in a second, but I want to show you one thing. To behold Jesus, to reawaken wonder, to be kids again, to read the fairy tales, to see and perceive who Jesus is. I want to show you a clip and give a little bit of context for this. This is from a show called Bluey. If you are young parents in the room, not young parents, parents of young kids, whatever, if that's you, you might be familiar with this. If not, I'll give a real fast context. So this is a kid's show. It's a cartoon. It's really beautiful and sweet, and I get teary-eyed just about every time I watch it. It's imaginative, and it's really cool because you parent, you get their perspective, and the kid gets perspective. It's great. The story is called Born Yesterday. And what happens in the story is basically they're trying to teach the girl dogs, the kid dogs, they're dogs, by the way. This is getting weirder. trying to teach them that, hey, we have experience, we have wisdom, we've been around longer. I wasn't born yesterday, right? And so then in that, they're like, why don't we play that game where you're actually born yesterday? And so the dad does it, and it's really funny. And then you see the girls learn the lesson at the end. We're going to watch like a two-minute clip. But what's really important is what happens with the dad. So notice the dad and see if you can catch what I'm getting at. I think it will kind of tie this all together. So check this clip out real quick. I think most of you caught it. What's he doing? He's beholding. He's seeing creation and the beauty of nature and all this stuff. He's not getting distracted by all this stuff. He's just sitting in the moment. Even after he's done playing the game, he goes back to it because he sees the value in it. And the girls realize we don't need to control this right now. Maybe even if you're a parent in the room, that might be one of the most freeing things for you in this season, is you don't have to control what Christmas looks like. Just behold it. Behold the wonder and the awe and the beauty of Jesus being celebrated. But that's what we can do in our lives. Behold Jesus, the baby king who came for us, took our place, stepped down, descended into humanity so that we might ascend into God, so that we could have him, life forever. Usually, this is going to require us doing the very thing we don't want to do. Bound, carried, vulnerable, humble. Another story in Israel And even just to give a little bit of context beforehand, I've been processing something in my own life. Derek said something pretty profound last Sunday where he said, maybe the thing that you did in your teens and your 20s just doesn't work anymore. And it, for me, it has to do with my pace of life and my rhythms and honestly my sleep, my physical well-being. And it's stuff I don't want to look at, stuff I don't want to deal with, but I know it's something that is keeping me from what God has next. And I had that kind of in the back of my head when I went on this trip to Israel, and I just was like, whatever, I'll deal with that later. And go to Israel, and there's a picture of one site that we went to, and this is the wilderness of Zin. This is the wilderness that the Israelites wander and walk through for 40 years. And I often think of that story as like, oh, that's terrible and tragic, and they missed an opportunity, and this sucks, it's not great. In reality, it's exactly where God wanted them to be, and it's exactly what they needed. And it makes me think of the verse in Isaiah that says, see, I'm doing a new thing. Now it springs up. Do you not perceive it? Do you not behold it? I'm making a way in the wilderness and streams in the wasteland. And so we're here, and Christy McClellan does this teaching. She talks about how God has a word for you in the wilderness. And I'm like, yes, I need that. Not thinking about the stuff I don't want to look at, but thinking I need the spectacle. I need the big vision. I need you to do something crazy and say something amazing about me. And I need you to say it like this, God. And so I go and I kind of put my AirPods in, and we're part of a large group, and I'm just kind of over that. It's like day two. I'm already over it. And it's like, okay, you guys go do your own thing, and I'm just gonna take my time, do my thing. And I see that the group, we're like hiking this, and we're walking through, and I see that the group has stopped, and Jen Smith's kind of in front of me, and I say, hey, are they waiting on me? She's like, no. And I'm about to say something that God just catches me and stops me dead in my tracks. And I say, good, I want to go at my own pace. And I felt like I just shattered to a million pieces. I felt like somebody punched me in the gut, because it was right there in that moment that God says, yeah, I know. I know you do, but I'm inviting you to go at my pace. It's the last thing I wanted to do, and it's the last thing I wanted to hear. Because it requires me to be humble and small and weak and vulnerable, even talking about it. But it's the thing that God has for me so that I could behold Jesus in my life. What is that for you? What's that thing? The small thing, the weak thing, the vulnerable thing, the becoming nothing thing, the thing you don't want to do, that will bring you into the best place to just behold who Jesus is. My hope for you is that Advent, as you wait, that you would bring yourself humbly before Jesus and just say, okay, I don't need this. Whatever that might look like, slowing down in this season. Maybe you've heard about this prayer and fasting. Fasting is becoming weak. Fasting is becoming vulnerable, becoming small, becoming humble. Maybe that's the last thing you want to do, and that's the exact thing you need to do. Maybe it's joining in a prayer hub. Maybe it's leading a prayer hub. Maybe you're so busy you can't even possibly fathom praying. And maybe that's the exact thing that God wants you to do right now. What is the thing, the small, weak, vulnerable, humble thing God is inviting you to be a part of? I don't have that figured out. I've been resisting this. This message is for me. But I hope you would join me in considering it. Would you grab your communion elements? Communion in itself is a remembrance of Jesus's humility and vulnerability and becoming small, becoming weak, and becoming nothing. He emptied himself for you and for me. He descended so we might ascend. He restored us back to God. And he's made all things right. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread and said, this is my body, which is broken for you, broken for me. Let's take and eat together. He then took the cup and said, this is my blood, which is poured out for you. This is a new story. He's redeeming our story because a child was born. Let's take and drink. Jesus, we just come before you, and in the week leading up to the day of your arrival, may we just behold who you are as King and Lord of all the earth, of the cosmos, of everything. You hold everything in your hands. You are the Almighty, and yet you became nothing for us. Would we do the same for you? Would we lay down every sin, every weight, everything that's holding us back? May we empty ourselves to you so that we could see you clearly and behold your wonder and your awe and your beauty. And may that mark us forever. Jesus, we love you. We thank you. It's in your name that we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, guys, grace and peace. We will see you for Christmas services this week. We hope you have a great week. Love y'all.
Peaceful wings unfurl, and still there. through the silence with glory in the highest, the hope of all creation resting in his mother's arms. A song on the horizon, ringing through the heavens, the long-awaited Savior, come to set the captives free. Come to set the captives free. Come set us free. If you need healing, he's where you find it. Lay down your burdens and breathe in forgiveness. And if you need freedom, yeah, he's where you find it.
Night that was so So much to be thankful for. It's Christmas. Oh, how I miss this. But through the joy and laughter, you can feel the sadness. 'Cause this Christmas, everyone's not